Good morning, everyone. You're all very welcome. I'd like to start our service by singing, "Thou hast snapped my fetters, thou hast made me free. Liberty and gladness I have found in thee." Could we stand as we sing?
Save the slave no longer. Lord. Let's bow our heads in prayer. We're going to come before the Lord, and we're going to remember those that are sick today and pray for them, that God will minister to them. Darren McElveen and Brother Wesley, we continue to pray for June Bellingham and Christina and her brother-in-law, Raymond Wright, and we continue to pray for David Loudon and Sammy Orr and Edna Scott, Beatrice McGarry and her daughter, and Patsy Doherty. We continue to pray for Alec Robinson and Dave Borland, Sam Bloomfield, Elizabeth McAreevy, and Peter Moy and Joanne Peden, Philip Archibald and his family. We continue to pray for them. We pray for Ray Laverday too, Johnny McCurdy and Gwenny Stewart and Robert Gilmore. Pray for Paula and Hazel and Jean Scott, Martin and Liz Moore, Alison McClellan and Bobby Todd and Bobby Archibald, Joan Hunter, and we continue to pray for Ellen Morris and Robert Hunter. Liz Henry, too, very much needs the Lord. We pray for Moira, that the Lord will touch and heal her. We pray for Gillian's mother, that the Lord will indeed undertake for her. The operation is postponed at the moment, so we just continue to pray for her. Eleanor Coulter, Don Logan, needs the Lord, and we pray for Martin McGarry, too. Tommy McCracken, Stuart Boyd, and Ruth McAleese. We pray for Pastor Dempster. Remember the Sunday school or the creche as they go to their classes. We do pray for the bereaved family. We pray for the Essler family. They buried their Ray was buried during the week, and we just pray for the family that God will be with them and bless them. We pray for the ministry of God's word, that God will bless his word to our hearts and our lives today. Here are many, many needs. And if you have a need, you just whisper to the Lord, and we'll include that one, dear one, in our prayers. Our gracious God and eternal Father in heaven, in the lovely and precious name of our Lord Jesus, we bow before thee and thank you, Lord, for this day. This is the day that the Lord hath made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. Father, we're thankful and grateful for the health and strength that we have to be here today, Lord. There's so many in hospital beds and in other homes, Lord, that would love to be here but cannot. But, oh God, we're here today and we're thankful and we're grateful to thee. We thank you, Lord Jesus, for salvation, the greatest gift that ever came our way, the gift of eternal life. Father, just to have this blessed assurance and know that we're redeemed by the precious blood of Jesus. We can sing, redeemed, have I love to proclaim it, redeemed by the blood of a lamb, redeemed through his infinite mercy, God's child, and forever I am. Father, we're so grateful to thee for all thy blessings. We think of those that are needing a touch of the Master's hand, and we just pray, Father, that you will minister to them, even those in our meeting tonight, today, Lord, that God, that you will, as they reach out to you, Lord, you will reach down to them and touch them and heal them in the lovely name of our Lord Jesus. Lord, will you bless your word to our hearts today? Open up our hearts and our understanding, Lord, to receive thy precious word in Jesus' name. Bless the children as they go to their class. We pray, Father, that you will bless them abundantly in the name of our Lord Jesus. Now, Father, we come around your lovely table, and what a privilege it is, Father, just to be able to remember you in this beautiful fashion as you have commanded us to do. Father, bless the table, bless the cup, bless the bread to our hearts, Lord, as we partake of it, for we ask it all in the name of Jesus. Amen. If you're a believer in the Lord Jesus, this morning we do invite you to join with us around the lovely table of remembrance. The Lord Jesus, on the same night in which he was betrayed, he took the bread, he broke it and said, "This is my body broken for you. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you show forth the Lord's death until he come."
Every day they pass me by, I can see it in their eyes. Empty people filled with care,
The Lord. Delighted to see you all this morning, and we give you a very warm welcome in the lovely name of our Lord Jesus. If you haven't had your copy of this month's newsletter, they're in the foyer there. If you would like to have a copy, please take one. If you'd like a CD of any of our services, you can have that by putting your name on the sheet at the back. 50p box is there, the pink box. If you'd like to contribute to that, we appreciate indeed those that do. And looking forward to this evening at 6:30 is our evangelistic service, and I will be the speaker. So let's pray for these meetings and pray that God will bless us abundantly in our evening service. I'm going to ask the praise team to come now and to sing for us.
Just want to thank everyone who has returned their sheets for us with your favorite hymn. We are working steadily through them, so we're spending the night awake and we're going through them, so you'll hopefully hear your favorite soon. These things take time, but it's on its way. We are here today with one called Bless the Lord, O My Soul, also known as 10,000 Reasons, and it's written by Matt Redmond, only took an hour to write, so it did, so pretty good going. I think that's when you're being inspired by the Lord, you can do those things. But it's based on Psalm 103, and it gives us 10,000 reasons why we should pray as God. So we'll do standard procedure, we'll go through it once again, and then second time through, stand to sing.
Thank you.
bit depleted. This morning's quite a few on holidays. We're going to turn to the Word of God now to 2 Samuel chapter 12. Second book of Samuel, chapter 12. My topic this morning is I want to look at a dark moment in David's life. 2 Samuel chapter 12, and we'll read from verse 1. And the Lord sent Nathan unto David, and he came unto him and said unto him, There were two men in one city, the one rich and the other poor. The rich man had exceeding many flock and herd, but the poor man had nothing save one little ewe lamb, which he had brought and nourished up, and it grew up together with him and with his children. It did eat of his own meat and drank of his own cup and lay in his bosom and was unto him as a daughter. And there came a traveller unto the rich man, and he spared to take of his own flock and of his own herd to dress for the wayfaring man that was come unto him, but took the poor man's lamb and dressed it for the man that was come to him. And David's anger was greatly kindled against the man. He said to Nathan, As the Lord liveth, the man that hath done this thing shall surely die, and he shall restore the lamb fourfold before he did this thing, because he did this thing, and because he had no pity. And Nathan said unto David, Thou art the man. Thus saith the Lord, God of Israel, I anoint thee king over Israel, and deliver thee out of the hand of Saul, and I give thee the master's house and thy master's wives unto thy bosom, and give thee the house of Israel and of Judah, and that thou hast been too, if that hast been too little, I would have given thee much, or given thee such and such a thing. God will bless to us his precious word. Amen. In 2 Samuel chapter 11, it tells us about the darkest moment in King David's life, as being blessed by the Lord in many, many ways, after reaching the pinnacle of success, after leading his nation to peace and prosperity and everything else, David fell into a deep, dark, despicable, and distinguished sin. Now, we all know that the story about David, how he succumbed to a giant named lust that lived within his own heart. He committed adultery with a married woman and got her pregnant. And then, in an effort to cover up that sin, David had her husband put to death. Chapter 11 closes with the sin of David hanging like a dark cloud over his life and over the nation. Now, we know that how God did not punish David immediately for his sin, but this does not mean that God merely turned a blind eye to his sin, not at all. God had a plan to reach out to David and to claim his life, and to reclaim his life, and to restore him to fellowship with the Lord again. Our text today speaks about this plan. What we learn here will, I believe, help us to, as we come to deal with our sin in the future. David found himself in a place in life that he never ever thought he would ever be in. There has been a time when David walked with God, and there was a time when he praised and magnified the Lord. And the Lord blessed David and blessed his life in a marvelous fashion. Now, David looks at the remnant of a broken vows. He sees the shattered dreams, ruined lives, wrecked future lying about him. He has sinned and he knows it. He's in a terrible way in the midst of all the tragedy. God speaks to David. God comes to him in his sin and exposes David's sin to him. God comes to him and he says, David, thou art the man. I would like to take that statement today. I want to look into this passage and consider the steps the Lord took to make this matter right. This awful situation. Between these chapters, there is a gap of some 12 months, a year. And during that time, there is no mention of David's sin by David, by God, or by anyone else. But this does not mean that those 12 months had been peaceful for David the king. They certainly weren't. His mind was in a turmoil. You see, sometimes what is said speaks louder than, or sometimes what is not said speaks louder than what is said. It was a time of silence. For nearly a year, David kept his sin hidden in his heart. There is no record of David telling anyone about the sin that he committed. Oh, he knew what he had done. And he was guilty of what he'd done. There was no joy in his heart. There was no peace in his mind. There was no anticipation over the birth of the baby. It was all pain and guilt. Joab knew. Some of the servants knew. Worst of all, David knew and God knew. Or David knew that God knew. This is how it is for all those who try to hide their sin in silence. The Bible is clear about this matter. Proverbs 28 and verse 13 says, he that covereth his sins shall not prosper. It seems that this episode in David's life prompted him to write at least two different Psalms. One of those was Psalm 32 and the other was Psalm 51. These Psalms were apparently written after David had confessed his sin, been forgiven by God and restored back to fellowship. He wrote these two Psalms. They tell us that David's months following the sin of Bathsheba, they were not carefree, not by any means. There was no love, there was no happiness within his heart. None of these days, David had suffered greatly. His entire life had grown unstable. He had suffered under the chastisement of the Lord, and he knew it. The guilt must have been unbearable. You can imagine what it would be like to carry this awful guilt within your heart and within your soul. Thus, it is for everyone who does not deal with their sin according to God's word. When we sin against the Lord, we can be sure that we will be chastised for it. Maybe not at the time, but we will be chastised for it. It may not come immediately, but it will come. That is the promise of God. Constant guilt, loss of joy, and loss of peace, the sense of God's displeasure, are all the regular companions of those who walk away from God and who refuse to deal with their sin. If we could learn to do it God's way, My goodness, we would save ourselves a lot of sorrow and heartache in our lives. We may wonder why the Lord waited to deal with David's sin, why he waited so long. One answer may lie that the fact that David probably was not ready to confront when the sin was first committed. God confronted David, and he did so at the perfect time to ensure the right response. God will use the time tactics in your life and mine. We may feel like we have gotten away with our sin. We might feel that, well, it's great, we've got away with it. How many people have said that? And when the time is right, he will confront our sins and he will bring us back to himself. God sent Nathan the prophet, a man David respected and loved, to confront his sin. This was a tough job for Nathan. Nathan came in with a story about the rich man and had many sheep. A man who took the only lamb belonging to this poor neighbor to feed a man who had been passing through, a wayfaring man. Nathan emphasized the fact that the poor lamb was precious to the man and represented all that the man had in the world. When David hears this tale, he was livid. He demanded that the rich man restore to the poor man fourfold, and then to order the rich man to be executed. Isn't it amazing that a man who had excused sin in his own life can be so harsh and critical when he's dealing with somebody else's life? Then David hears these words that he never thought that he would ever hear in his life. Nathan looked at him straight in the eye and he says, "Thou art the man, David. Thou art the man. You took the only thing Uriah had in his life and you took his life. You had it all, but you wanted more. Thou art the man, David." David had been exposed. He had been found out. You see, God eventually dealt with David's sin. The sin that was so carefully hidden away and is exposed for all to see and all to hear. A traveler named Lust came to a place one evening, and David fed that stranger, a beautiful woman named Bethesda. Now there is a price to pay, a great price. Never think for a moment that a sin can be successfully hidden away forever. Can't. God knows exactly where it is buried and when the time is right to dig it up. He will place his finger right on the sore spot, and he will press hard. He will confront that sin, that hidden sin, and expose it for what it is. That will be a shock, and it will be a shocking day in the life of the guilty party when that happens. That is why it is so important that we keep short accounts with God, that we should confess our sins to God and tell the Lord about it, not hide it. I think Nathan's heart was broken over having to confront his friend. By the way, there are many, many, there may come a day when you might have to confront somebody about their sins. In the course of my ministry, I've had to do that, and it's a horrible, horrible thing. If that day comes, do not do it with anger, and don't do it with self-righteousness. Do it with a spirit of love and with a broken heart. And I believe that that's how Nathan did it, realizing the grace of God is present. God's grace, we should show God's grace in a time like this Now David is reminded of all that the Lord had done for him. All the good things. God had chosen him, saved him, blessed him, elevated him to the throne of Israel. He had done wonderful things for him. God had given him more than he could ever have imagined. And God would have given him even much more had he wanted it. And he knew how David, and now David repays him in this sort of a fashion. What a stirring rebuke. Surely it melted the heart of King David. The blessing of God and the grace of God that we have that had been given ought to have served as a shield against all the evil and against all the sin that was floating in his mind. To think of all that he had done for us, and then to consider how we treat God at times. The Lord deserves far, far better than we, as his children, give him. You can almost hear the sadness in the voice of Nathan, the prophet here, as he asks the pitiful question in verse 9, why did you do this, David? Why? After the Lord had been so good to you, how could you? It must have broken the heart of the Lord to see this man who was called a man after God's own heart in this pitiful condition. Must have broken the Lord's heart. I would imagine that our sins hurt the Lord deeply. Look at all he has done for us. He loved us. He gave his son to die for us. He saved us when we should have been dropped into hell. He has given us all the wonderful things that we need. Lifted our burden, blessed us 10,000 little ways. And we act like as we owe him nothing. When sin comes our way, we forget who we are. We forget about the Lord and we lose ourselves in the pleasure of the moment like David did. I know it must be heartbreaking. When David hears the changes suddenly, his mind is clear. For the first time in months, he can see the situation just as it is. And he makes a full, honest confession. And as soon as David confesses, he is told that his sins have been forgiven and that he will not be put to death as the law demanded then. He should have been put to death. Instead of justice, David received mercy and grace. That's our God. That's the God that we serve today. He had been forgiven. He had been pardoned. He is restored. Here is what David said happened when he dealt with his sins in Psalm 32. Blessed is those whose transgression is forgiven and whose sin is covered. Blessed is the man unto whom the Lord imputeth not iniquity and in whose spirit there is no guile. When I kept silent, my bones waxed old through my roaring all the day long, for day and night thy hand was heavy upon me, and my moisture was turned into drought of summer. I acknowledge my sins unto thee, and mine iniquity have I hid not. I said, I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord. Thou forgivest the iniquity of my sin. This is how God always operates. When sin is confessed openly and honestly, it is forgiven by the Lord. God is merciful. David is told that God put away his sins. That phrase means to take away, to pass over. God took David's sin and he took them away from him. As far as David and God was concerned, they were gone forever. That is a blessing, and that is what happens when we come to him for forgiveness. When we deal with our sins in an open, honest confession, God forgives them and he removes the stain in our lives. That is how sin is handled, and when it is forgiven and restored, there's always good results. But you know something? There's always consequences. Always remember that. There are always consequences. This fact that David was forgiven and cleansed, and all the sins were removed and had taken place, the next few verses teaches us the truth that David paid for his sin. There was a permanent consequence. Because David had seen to it that Uriah had been killed in a violent way. The violence would never depart from David's family, never. He would later lose his three only sons in a violent manner. The sin David committed affected him and his family for many, many years to come. He would see his wives treated with the same contempt as Bathsheba did. His own son Absalom would go into his father's wives in a public view. Remember, sin pays bad wages. David paid a high price for a night of sin. Sin is horrible. It destroys everything in front of us. There may come a time when you will hear God say to you, "Thou art the man," or "Thou art the woman." That time may be today if these are issues in your life that need to be dealt with today. Now is the time to bring them to God. Now is the time to confess them. If you have never trusted the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior and Lord and Master, then the most important thing to do is get saved. Deal with it now. Come to Jesus and be saved. Come to Jesus and confess your sins before Him, and He will forgive you. He will save you. He will deliver you. He will set you gloriously and wonderfully free. Shall we pray? Our loving Father in heaven, we thank you again, Father, for your precious word. Lord, we stand upon your word. Your word is ever true. Father, we thank you that you never lie. You will never lead us astray. You will never lead us down wrong roads. We thank you, Father, for your faithfulness, your grace, and your love, and your forgiveness. We thank you for all the mercies that you so kindly bestowed upon us each day. And Father, why would we want ever to sin against Thee? Why would we want to be unfaithful to Thee? When we think of all that you have done for us, when you think, Lord, of you lifting us out of the very gutter of sin, placing our feet upon a rock, establishing our goings, even putting a new song in our mouth. Father, we're so thankful and so grateful. Help us, keep us on the paths of your righteousness for Jesus' sake. Father, will you bless the evening service? We look forward to another great time in the gospel. We just pray, Father, that you will come down and bless us abundantly. Grant that indeed, Lord, some soul or souls will come to know Jesus as their Savior and Lord and Master. We ask these things in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. We're going to sing a closing hymn together. They nailed my Lord upon a tree and left him dying there. Through love he suffered there for me. 'Twas love beyond compare. Let's stand as we sing. They nailed